prosper. And when the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. My God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. And every war he wages, he will. come on, hallelujah. That's a word for somebody this morning, hallelujah. Come on, you take what is meant for evil. That's how God works. He will turn it for our good, amen. Hallelujah. Come on, hallelujah. We are going to see a victory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. When we come with the expectation, hallelujah. Come on, that's how faith works. Even though we don't see it, but we believe that our God is still moving in our behalf. Hallelujah. Come on, let that be an encouragement to somebody this morning. Hallelujah. You will see a victory. You will see a victory. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on. Hallelujah. I know there's a praise deep down on the inside of you. Hallelujah. Come on. Give it all to Him. Come on. Raise your voice like He. Hallelujah. He is good. He is good. Yeah. You take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Come on. Speak it over your life.
You take what the enemy meant for evil.
Stop us from worshiping God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Not our circumstances, not what's all around us. As believers, hallelujah, we worship Him because He is a miracle working God.
Working in
Us here today, Lord. Father God, that you'll bless each and every one here today, Father. We thank you, Lord, for what you are doing. We thank you, Lord, that you said that you will never leave us nor forsake us, that you are with us, Father God, all the way, Lord. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. And everybody say, Amen. Hallelujah. Come on.
Amen. Isn't it good to be in the presence of the Lord? And I just miss worshiping together like this. Isn't it amazing? There is a word for somebody today for a healing. If you've had lower back pain on the left side, there's a word today for you that God is going to heal you right now in the name of Jesus. I don't know who that's for, but Father, we pray, we just release that word of healing, Lord, over somebody today. God, that's been suffering and has lower back pain. Maybe they're watching online or they're here today. Lord, we just pray for them right now that by your stripes we are healed, and we just speak the word of faith over their life. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody said amen. 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 Come on, how many are excited to be in the house of the Lord today? It's just nice to be able to say that. Come on. So good. So good. Thank you for coming out today. And man, it's hot, huh? Hot outside, but thank God we're inside today. Amen. Just wanted to say again, just really, really quickly, how much we've missed you guys. And thank you for coming today. And we did a live recording last Sunday. We record before the Sunday, but last Sunday we did a live recording, which we had live the worship, and then I came up and spoke right afterwards, and so the praise team was here. And man, I was enjoying that worship last week so powerfully, and I just felt like, oh, I feel so bad that other people are not here enjoying it, but this week you're here, so praise God for that. Amen. Amen. And so the Lord is good. He is faithful. I just want to remind you, hey, we're going to go back to prayer. And so we're starting prayer again Wednesday night, 6:30. It's just going to be a time of worship and prayer and pursuit. We call it pursuit because we're going after the presence of the Lord. And we just want more of Him. And then the last Sunday in August, we're going to kick off. We're going to start 21 days of prayer. And I believe that of all the times that we have done 21 days of prayer, this is probably going to be the most critical one. And we've had some powerful times, but I really believe that this 21 days of prayer in the month of September we're going to push back the darkness. Amen. And we're going to call forth the light of the glory of God. I believe that the glory of God is ready to be revealed like we have never seen. I really believe that, like we have never seen. And as darkness increases, come on, light increases even more. And so we're believing for that. Something supernatural is going to happen. I want to begin. How many are ready for the Word of God? Anybody ready today? Man, I had to be careful during that worship. I almost lost my voice just worshiping. I can't do that. All right, we got to go today. So I want to talk to you today about just a simple, actually a question, as what should we be doing right now as believers, as Christians? What should we be doing? What should be our focus? How should we be living? How should we be managing our life, our finances, our health, our emotions, our spiritual life, all of that? And so that's what I want to talk about. And I don't want to forget those that are watching online too. I don't want to forget about you. So thank you for joining us, those that are watching online this morning as well. But I have been trying to spend some time listening, like you, I'm sure, to what is God saying to us right now as the people of God? What does He want us to do? And, you know, I've been trying to pray and get in the Word. I've been listening to prophets. I love listening to the prophets and hearing what God is saying through them. But I believe that more than ever, we need to hear the voice of God. So that's what I want to talk about today. I want to talk about what should we be doing? What should our focus be on right now during this season? I already talked about that we're going to begin 21 days of prayer. So that's coming up. But I want to look today I'm going to look today at, we're going to look together at 2 Timothy chapter 4. But before we get to chapter 4, I just wanted to back up to a couple of verses at the end of chapter 3 in 2 Timothy, because it's going to give us a little bit of context. So 2 Timothy 3 in verse 14, again, this is Paul. He's writing to Timothy, who's a younger minister that Paul has been mentoring. Paul's really at the end of his life, kind of at the tail end of his life, and it's kind of like his last words to this young preacher that he's been mentoring. And so in verse 14, I guess I'll start in chapter 3, he says, "But you must remain faithful." Come on, that's a good word right there. We could just preach about that all day long, right? "But you must remain faithful to the things that you have been taught, for you know they are true, and you know that you can trust those who have taught you. You have been taught the Holy Scriptures from childhood and have been given, and you have been, they have given you the wisdom to receive the salvation that comes by trusting in Christ Jesus." And then verse 16, look at this. He says, "All Scripture is inspired by God, and it is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives." Come on, we need to know what's wrong in our lives. We need to know the Word of God, what's true, what is wrong in our life, because it can correct us and corrects us when we are wrong and teaches us to do what is right. Now, God, look at this. This is how God uses the Word of God. This is how He uses the Scripture. God uses it to prepare. Just remember that word. We're going to come back to that word. God uses it to prepare and equip His people to do every good work. Now, that's chapter 3, but really, as you know, in the original, there are no chapter divisions, so let's just, he keeps writing in this letter, chapter 4, verse 1, he says, "I solemnly urge you in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, who will someday judge the living and the dead when He comes to set up His kingdom." This is what I want you to hear today. He says, "Preach the Word of God." Preach the Word of God. So I want you to hear this today, because this is Paul. I believe that he's talking to us this morning as well, that we need to preach the Word of God. We need to be prepared. There's that word again. Whether the time is favorable or not, it doesn't matter, right? Then he says, "Patiently correct, rebuke if you have to, right? And encourage your people with good teaching." Verse 3, he says, "For a time is coming." Come on, do you think it's here? "For the time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow," look at this, "they will follow their own desires, and they will look for teachers." They will seek out teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. They will reject the truths, and they will chase after myths. So here is Paul's teaching. He says there's a time coming where people are going to reject the truth and they're going to chase after myths. They're going to chase after the things of the world, things that are untrue, things that, you know, the world has told us some things that are wrong about us, wrong about God, myths about God, myths about life and relationships and our past and all of that. And, you know, one of the most common myths that we hear that people today will say in our society is, it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you're sincere. You ever heard anybody say that? You know, just as long as you're sincere. Come on. That sounds good. It sounds, you know, unbiased. It sounds politically correct, you know. But the truth is, that is absurd, because there's just some things that are opposite. Two things cannot be true. They're an opposite. And so what I'm here to say is, you can be sincere, but you can also be sincerely wrong. And so you can have a sincere heart, but you've got to base your life on something. And it's not supposed to be based upon our own desires, what we feel, what we like. There are some things that I read in the Word of God that are difficult for me to hear. I'm like, oh, man, did you have to say it that way, right? Come on, we can be honest, right? But it doesn't really matter how I feel. If it's the Word of God, that's what we base our life on. And it's important what we believe, because our beliefs are going to determine our behavior. They're going to determine the direction of our life. It's important. If you believe that God doesn't care about you, you'll never pray. If you believe that God is mad at you and God is judgmental, you will run from God, right? So it's important that we get our beliefs and that we base our beliefs on the Word of God. Now, what today is causing people to believe the wrong things, right? The media. The media, whether it's the news, whether it's the social media. I'm here to say it very clear. The prince of the air is working through, he's called the prince of the air. He works through the airwaves. That's how he communicates his message. And as believers, we got to have wisdom. We got to have discernment to say, you know what? I am not just going to blindly follow what they are pushing. I'm not going to follow their agenda. I am going to build my life on the Word of God. The Word of God is going to be my authority. It's going to be the basis for my belief. It's going to be the guidebook for my life. It's going to be the standard. Now listen, you're either going to base your life on the world or you're going to base your life on the Word of God. And we want to make sure that we will base our life on the Word of God. All right. So let's go back to our text. In verse 2, he says, preach the Word of God. Don't preach your opinions, right? Don't preach what the world says just because it's politically correct. No. Preach the Word of God. That is what we need to hear. Whether the time is favorable or not, we should be preaching the Word of God. And so if that's number one, if you want to take notes today, you can write that down, is what should we be doing right now? We should be preaching the Word of God very clearly. And let me just add before we move on, is that the first person that we need to preach to is ourselves. Come on, before we get on social media, before we get on Facebook and tell somebody else what they need to be doing, we should be preaching to ourselves. We should be using the Word of God. We should not only be reading the Word of God, we should let the Word of God read us and tell us, hey, this is what needs to change in our life. I do this every Sunday. Before I come up here and I preach to you, you think you're at the first service this morning, but really you're at the second one because I've already preached to myself. I have to preach to myself, right? Last week, for instance, we were talking and there was a word that just jumped out of me last week. It just was in my spirit, and that was in the book of Revelation where it talks about how cowardly people will not enter into heaven. That shook me. I mean, it just shook me, right? And it was a word. And so last week, I shared it to the church. I shared it with you. But before I preached it to you, I preached that to myself. I needed to hear that word. And Paul is telling Timothy, preach the word. And what I want to say is, yes, preach it to yourself. Come on, get in the mirror and preach to yourself. What needs to be corrected in your life? What needs to be changed? Come on, what are things that you're just, and me, the things that we're just following our own desires? I never thought I would live in a day where Christians would be the ones that were mad for us opening the church up. It's unbelievable, the time that we're living in. And so we need to make sure because as Christians, we're going to be facing persecution. It's here. And he says in the text, he says in verse 3, the time is coming. People will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires. And they will look for teachers who tell them whatever their itching ears. Have you ever had an itch where you just, like, you know, I drive Sharice nuts because I don't even have to say anything. She just knows that if I just kind of start moving this way, she knows that, come on, you got to scratch it. And that's what Paul is saying. There's some people, they have an itch, they have a desire, right? And they look for somebody to scratch that, to tell them what they already believe, to confirm what their own thoughts that are not based on the Word of God. Before we preach to anybody else, we have to preach to ourselves. Come on, Christians, come on, believers. Before we preach to anybody else, come on. What do we need to be changing in our life, right? What do we need to hear? What do we need to hear? And so we got to base our life on the Word of God. In John 8:31, Jesus said, he said this to people, look at this, it says, Jesus said to the people who believed in him. He's not talking to unbelievers. Are you guys with me? He's not talking to people who don't know the Bible. No, he's actually talking to people who actually believed in him. And this is what he said to them. You are truly my disciples. Yeah. That's a big word, isn't it, right? That's a condition, right? That's a conditional, right? If you remain faithful to my teachings, right? And then he says, if you remain faithful, you got to see this connection. Then you will know the truth, and then the truth will set you free. So what is he saying? What is he teaching us? He says, listen, if you remain faithful, if you say, you know what? I'm going to chase after God. You know what? The Word of God is going to be my standard. I don't care what the world is doing. The whole world can be going in this direction. All the media, all the stuff on, it just seems like everybody's going in this direction. But if God is going in the opposite direction, that's the direction I'm going in, right? And God says that when you follow, when you're faithful to that, right, the truth of the Word of God will set you free. Things will begin to fall off of your life. Truth is not something you know. Truth is something that you, is something, hello?
Yeah.
Come on, right? Truth is something that you actually practice in your life. It's not just some belief. It's something that you apply, something that you follow. This verse in Corinthians is so important for us. 1 Corinthians 9:27, again, it's Paul speaking. He said, I discipline, 1 Corinthians 9:27, he says, I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. Otherwise, everybody say otherwise. He says, I fear that after preaching to others, I myself might be qualified. It is so important. Are you with me? Did you guys get this point? That we've got to preach to ourselves. We don't want to be shouting from the rooftops and lose our own soul, right? We've got to make sure that we are hearing the Word of God for ourselves. After we do that, then we are called to preach the good news to other people. And that's important. And can I just make sure that we're all clear on this? We're going to continue to preach the Word of God. We're going to preach the good news. No matter what they say or how they say it, we are not going to stop preaching the good news. And I know that the enemy is doing everything in his power to stop the Word of God from going forth. He is. He's trying to stop the Word of God, preaching of the good news. Come on, the good news can change somebody's life. But the enemy is not going to stop the Word of God from going forth. We are going to preach the Word of God. What should we be doing right now? We should be preaching the Word of God. We should be telling everybody we know about the saving message of Jesus Christ. Get your testimony. Come on, get it ready so that you're ready to share the good news with somebody else. Amen. I believe that the enemy would love for the church just to be online. Because if it's online, the enemy can censor it. It's coming. Trust me. They may cut me off right now. I don't know. But it's coming that when we start preaching against sin, adultery, come on, lying, cheating, homosexuality. I mean, when you just start going down the line and you start preaching against sin, they're going to start censoring you. Oh, that's hate speech. You shouldn't say that. That's discriminatory. I'm telling you that we're not going to stop preaching the Word of God just because Google, Facebook, YouTube, they don't like it. We're not going to stop preaching the Word of God. Amen? And we're not going to be mean. We're going to do it in love, but we are going to preach the Word of God. All right. Now, the second thing I want us to see is what should we be doing? Number two is that we should be preparing. If you're a believer, what should you be doing right now? You should be preparing. He says in verse 2, be prepared. Now, I was a Boy Scout. I don't know if there's any other Boy Scouts in here, but That's a long time ago, but yeah. When I was a little Boy Scout, our motto was always, any Boy Scouts in here? Always be prepared, right? That was our motto, always be prepared. And I think that is important. It taught us some good values. When Jesus was with his disciples and he was teaching his disciples, he was constantly trying to prepare them for what was coming. He would say things like, I'm leaving, I gotta go, but don't worry, the Holy Spirit's gonna come and you're gonna be okay. And he would say things like, I'm gonna be killed, but I'm gonna rise again. And they weren't listening to him. It wasn't cluing into them. And even though Jesus was trying to prepare them, the problem was they were preoccupied with today. And sometimes as believers, we're so preoccupied with paying the mortgage, taking care of our kids, and doing our jobs and whatever, that we forget to be prepared for what's coming. There are some things that are coming. Hello, somebody. You say, James, what is coming? Well, I can tell you there's some things that are coming. Troubles are coming. I know you're not excited about that, but difficulties are coming. Suffering's coming. Tribulations are coming. But I can also tell you that revival is coming. That miracles are coming. Breakthroughs are coming. Opportunity is coming. Favor is coming. And what we need to do, we need to be prepared for the difficulties that are going to come our way, and we need to be prepared for the opportunities that are going to come our way. Amen. We should be prepared spiritually. Listen, get your life right with God. If you've been playing around and messing around, now is the time to repent. Yeah. Come on, turn back to God. Put your faith in him. This is no time to be playing around. This is a time to be serious and get your faith. Listen, if you got unforgiveness, let go of it. It's not worth it. It's not worth to miss what God has for you. If you got bitterness, let go of it. Envy, jealousy, come on, let go of it. Get rid of it. Get your prayer life back on track. Get in the Word of God. Come on, base your life on kingdom values. Listen for that voice of God. We should be prepared spiritually. We should be prepared emotionally. We need to make sure that our emotions right now are not crazy. We need to make sure that we're physically helpfully. We need to make sure that we're prepared financially. Just really quickly, I'm not a financial advisor, but I can give you this wisdom. Don't spend all that stimulus money. Come on. Maybe you said, you're too late. Make sure that you prepare financially. There are some things coming down the road. I'm not a prophet, but I know from Scripture, come on, that there are difficulties. There's some things happening, and we need to be prepared. Get out of debt. Buy some extra food and supplies so that you can help other people when they're in need. Amen. We need to be ready. We need to make sure that we have some extra peace so that we can give it out to other people. We need to make sure that we're prepared and we have some extra joy, because there's a lot of anger. Come on, there's a lot of craziness out there, and you need to be able to give the extra that you have to somebody else. You need to make sure that you have some extra Holy Ghost in your life, some Holy Spirit in your life, right? I'm telling you, the Lord is coming back soon. We need to make sure that we're prepared. So in verse 5, he says, come on, I'm still talking about that we need to be preparing. He says, but you should keep, verse 5, but you should keep a clear mind in every situation. So how should we prepare? We should make sure that our minds are clear, because our mind is the battleground, right? It's the key to happiness and peace in our life. We want to make sure that when bad things happen and from difficulties happen, that we don't think that God is mad at us. We got to make sure that we are thinking soberly. We got to make sure that we don't panic, but that we have the peace of God. I'm talking about, he says here, make sure that you have a clear mind in every situation so that you don't go crazy, so that you don't respond crazy. When somebody says something to you and attacks you on Facebook, listen, don't respond back to them. Make sure, yes, pray for them. Make sure you have a clear mind. Yes, there's some things that are going to happen, but we got to make sure that our head is on straight. There is a spirit in this world that is influencing and affecting people's mind. People are raging. People are angry. People are violent. And the Bible talks about there is principalities and there are spirits. Come on, people, rational people are becoming irrational. And we got to make sure, listen, that spirit is out there. You're either being led by the Holy Spirit. Hello? Are you being led by the spirit of this world? Come on, an evil spirit? There's only one or two options. You can say, I just want to play it neutral. You don't have a choice to play it in neutral. You're being influenced by one or the other. And we got to make sure, I've got to make sure that I am not letting this spirit of violence and rage and anger. I got to make sure, listen, I got to make sure that I don't allow that to affect me. Because, man, you know, somebody says something to you. Woo! All that Holy Ghost just drains out of you, and you got to get refilled with the Holy Spirit, right? All right. We got to be prepared. Now, listen, when he goes on to say in this verse, he says, don't be fearful of suffering. Now, I know this message is a little bit, I mean, I like to talk about blessings and favor and all that, but I want to make sure that you see this in the text. He says, don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord. Don't be afraid, because you know what? God's going to protect you. God's going to keep you. Amen. It's going to happen. Stuff is going to happen. Persecution is going to happen, but God has our back. Come on. And there's always going to be, listen, anytime that you stand up for the word of God, you're going to be in opposition to the enemy. Evil, come on. Evil is going to rage and stuff is going to happen, but we do not have to fear. And we have to make sure that when we're facing, I want you to see this, when we're facing opposition, when we're facing people coming against us, we got to remember and recognize the source. It's not other people. Hello, come on. Our co-workers. It's not the people from the other political party. It's not them. Hello, come on, come on. It's not coming from those people that you quit following on Facebook. It is coming from Satan. There is a spirit. Do you hear me? There is a spirit behind, and we can't, the Bible tells us not to fight in the flesh and blood, right? Oh, you said this. Well, let me say this. No, we cannot do that. We are not allowed to do that as believers. We're not allowed to get ugly. We got to make sure, come on, that we operate in love, that we operate. Did I tell you that I always have to preach to myself first? Yeah, you know where this is coming from, right? We have to operate in love and kindness and forgiveness, right? And remember that Satan is the accuser. Satan is the accuser. And Satan hates God, but he can't hurt God. So he goes after God's children, right? So we have to know where it's coming from. And so when somebody says something, when those other people say something again, we have to refuse to retaliate against them. Come on. This is a tough message. I know. I had to preach it to myself first, right? We have to refuse to retaliate and say no, because I know where the source is. I'm not saying you're demon-possessed. I'm just saying I know where the source is. I want to say you're demon-possessed, but then I'd be fighting in the flesh again. I can't do that, right? But I know where the source is. Now listen, there have been times where I have allowed the spirit, the demonic spirits, the prince of this air, to allow that attitude to get on me. And I've had to shake that off and say, no, I can't do that. I can't live that way. I'm not going to live that way. I'm not going to come under that influence. The Bible says in Romans 12:21, do not be overcome. Do we have Romans 12:21? Do not be overcome by evil. Romans 12:21. But overcome evil with good. So check this out. We can't retaliate, but we do have to bless. Even though they said something to us, we have to bless them. That's what it means to be a Christian. And listen, I know I'm praying. I am praying that there is such a distinction between the people of God and the people of this world that they're going to see miracles and they're going to see Christians being saved and protected and kept, all of that. And I'm praying for that. But I'll tell you, another distinction is when we have a heart of love and joy and kindness, and we don't get into that exchange back and forth. And oh, I'll keep my head down. I'll just keep on preaching. All right, come on. I'm still talking about being prepared. I know I'm going on a little bit here, but I don't have time to get into it. Maybe I'll talk about it another week. But in Matthew 25, Jesus talks about the 10 bridesmaids. And he talked about when he was going to come back, and that there were 5 wise and 5 foolish. And the 5 that were wise, they had extra. Come on. Extra. They were prepared. They had some extra oil. The 5 unwise, they didn't have enough. They weren't prepared. So we need to make sure that we're prepared spiritually. Come on. We need to make sure that we're prepared in every area of our life so that we can have some extra, so that we can be a blessing and not be in need of a blessing. Let me say that again. We need to make sure that we put ourselves in a position where we can be a blessing and not be in need of a blessing. Amen? So that when somebody responds to us, we got so much love and so much joy and so much peace. We say, oh, that's okay. Don't even worry about it. I've lost my temper 100 times. I love you. I forgive you. Come on. Come on. Come on, right? All right. Here you go. All right. Last point. Last point. I want to go back and read verse 6 of 2 Timothy. I don't know if you have it. 2 Timothy chapter 6, chapter 4, verse 6. He says here, as for me, my life. Now Paul is talking about himself. He says, as for me, my life has already been poured out as an offering to God. And the time of my death is near. This is Paul speaking. He's at the end of his life. I have fought the good fight. Oh, come on. Don't you want to be able to say that? I have finished my race. I have remained faithful. Man, that's what I want to be able to say, right? And now a prize awaits me for the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on the day of his return. And the prize, look at this. And the prize, he says, it's not just for me. It's what he's saying, Paul. It's not just for me. He says, but it's for all who are, look at these words, eagerly looking forward to his appearing. And so the last point for us, what should we be doing right now? We should be looking forward with expectation. We should be looking forward. Listen, I know it's crazy right now. Come on. I watch the news too. I know it's crazy. But this is the greatest time to ever be living. Right now, we're going to see some of the greatest. Come on, am I talking to any believers in here? Did we leave? Come on, right? This is the greatest time to be alive. It's the greatest time to be in church. It's the greatest time to be serving God, because we're going to see some incredible miracles like we have never seen before. I believe that the greatest revival, I mean, there have been prayer warriors and intercessors who've been praying and praying and pleading before God for this great revival. And I'm telling you, we are going to see it. We're going to see the goodness of the Lord. We're going to see, come on, the Holy Spirit being poured out like we have never seen the Holy Spirit being poured out. We're going to see miracles and healings. Like, I'm so excited. Come on, I just believe and we are looking. Come on. We're not to be in fear. Come on, believers. It's not the end of the world. We should be looking forward and say, no, come on. God is ready to do something great. God is ready to do some miracles in my life. And I don't want to have my head down in fear. I want to have my head up, eagerly looking, expecting God to do something miraculous in my life. Come on, would you stand with me today? Come on, do you believe that God can do something great in your life? Come on. I believe some of the greatest things in the next few months are going to happen for us as a people of God. We're going to see miraculous things. Are we going to see some crazy things? Yeah, probably some crazy things as well. But don't be afraid. Two more minutes, just real quick. Just quick. Do you remember the story where God brought the people out of Egypt? You remember that? But before he brought them out, there were the plagues. You remember that? And there were 10 plagues, right? And these plagues, the purpose of them was to show the glory of God, the power of God, that the one true God was greater than Pharaoh, who claimed to be God. And so the first plague came, right? The water being turned into blood. And could you imagine? I mean, that's an incredible miracle, right? God was showing his power. But if you were an Israelite, that would have shook you up too. Hey, that's kind of crazy. Come on, you think? I mean, come on. I mean, right? I mean, even though it's the miracle, it's your God showing that he's greater, you're seeing this thing happening in front of you, that could kind of shake you up a little bit. And then the frogs come. And you remember, we can talk about this another day, because I think this is something very interesting. The magicians from Egypt were able to duplicate. They were able to turn water into blood. Don't ask me. I don't know. They were being influenced by demonic powers and all that kind of stuff. They were able to multiply frogs as well. That's crazy. Come on, just help me out a little bit. Just tell me, yes, James, that's crazy. It's crazy, right? Think about it. Powers, demonic powers can do that. But the third plague, the gnats, they tried to duplicate that, but they couldn't do it. They couldn't do it. And then in the fourth plague, God said, this time I'm going to show a distinction between my people and Egypt. And I'm going to protect them. And I'm going to show, look, I can protect my people with all of these plagues going on all around them. That's a word from somebody. It's a word from somebody. And I believe God is going to put this Goshen, this idea, we're going to be like this Goshen territory. That's where the people of Israel live. That's where God is going to protect us, even while all this stuff is going on. But remember, the first couple ones, the Israelites, they got to see that. So don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. God is still in control. Hello, come on. Don't be afraid. God is in control. And there is coming a great distinction of the glory of God. I don't know how else to say that, but there is a great distinction of that God is going to show forth his glory. So get ready. Preach to yourself. Get in the mirror. Preach to yourself the word of God. Amen. Preach to others. Prepare. Make sure you got oil in your lamp. You're ready. Make sure you have not only oil in your lamp, but you have some extra ready to go. And look forward. Don't look behind. Don't look down. Look forward and believe the goodness of God, the protection of God, the glory of God. It's all around you today. Amen. I'm going to ask our prayer team to come on down today. Prayer team, come on down. And today, I want to pray for you today. I want to pray that God would protect you, that God would watch over you. But I pray that God would fill you to overflowing. The oil representing the Holy Spirit, that you would just be so full of the Holy Spirit. I said it last week, I'm going to say it again. Pray in tongues. Pray in the Spirit. Come on, tap into the Holy Spirit, what He's doing. Father, I thank you today. I thank that God, that you know what you're doing. God, I don't know everything that's coming, but I know who holds the future. And today, Lord, we put our trust in you. Come on, would you just whisper that to him? Tell him, Lord, I trust you. Come on, if you're watching online, tell him, Lord, I trust you, Jesus. I put my faith in you, Lord Jesus. I'm not going to be fearful. I'm not going to live in worry. I'm not going to live in anxiety. I'm not going to go hide out in any cave. Come on, come on. I'm going to put my trust in you. I'm going to preach the word of God to myself. I'm going to live by the word of God. I'm going to be free. I'm going to be free in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you today, God, that you're at work right now. And I just pray, God, that we would prepare, that we would make sure that we're thinking clearly, that our minds are not clouded by this world and by what the media is saying, but that we would spend more time in the Word of God than we have ever spent before, Lord, that we would just meditate on the Word of God, that we would soak in the Word of God. Lord, today I pray for anybody today, Lord, that they would say, I just want a fresh start with you, I want a new beginning, God, that you would just give them that fresh start. They would make you the Lord and the Savior of their life. We pray for that in Jesus' name, I pray. Everybody said amen? Amen. Amen. If you want prayer, our prayer team, they're down here to pray with you. God bless you in Jesus' name.